Hi folks, and welcome to Chateau de Survival Part 2. I've done a bit of work on the insides. I mean, I was fully intending to make a copy of this before doing anything because I'm still not 100% satisfied with the outside, if you know what I mean. Now, you have to bear with me because there's a chance, a possibility, that we might end up getting visited by an invisible creeper at some point. So you're going to have to bear with me. A snowball fight might break out, so in which case I'm just going to arm myself just in case. You never know with these invisible creepers. Anything could happen at any time. They might show up at any moment. Get it? Invisible creeper, forget it. Anyway, so how far have I got and how have I been getting on? Well, I've started on introducing mechanics into various bits and pieces, and I'm not 100% sure where this is going to go, to be honest. We're going to have to work out various bits that are going to go at various levels. But I've got the key mechanics in. So we're going to start with looking at the bottom, where I've already put a few bits and pieces in. And you can see that here we have a simple kelp farm, which is actually producing a reasonable amount of kelp. It's relatively straightforward. You have the kelp tucked down there, above which, encased in water, obviously. And pistons and observers, which then go out to a row of hoppers. There's a row of hoppers in there to bring things in. And at the arse end of the observers, you can see the red stem. We have two of the usual chickenators working at full cluck. And yeah. We have also some sugarcane farms tucked in the corner here. Finding uses for these towers is a bit difficult, but you can see what's... Oops, we've picked up some kelp. This can happen when you get too close to this transport mechanism. You can end up picking things up. The we've got the soul sand going all the way up, and you can see what's going on. And excuse me, something in my teeth. A dispenser with a comparator, which then has a sticky piston, which has two observers, which are sanitized by a repeater on second tick at the moment. That is second tick as in 0, 1, 2, and 3. That's on number 2. And yeah, that's what's sending things up. Now, haven't done a lot down here, but around here is a spiral staircase. Quite an easy, straightforward design, and goes up a couple of levels. You can see on this level there's nothing here at the moment. No clue, no idea what I'm going to put in there. The fishing machine may be in here, along with the railway duplicator and a few other odds and sods. You can see, obviously, as the upwards mechanism is here, we could interject in here at any point. So that would be quite reasonable. Sorry, whatever's stuck in my teeth is really getting to me. Bear with me a second. Well, it's gone now. So, spiraled staircase isn't exactly the best. Still working on it. And exactly how I'm going to light this, I'm not sure. I might actually put... what might I put? I might put some... Where is it? The sea light. There it is. Sea lantern. I might actually put sea lanterns in the structure itself, which might work. I'm going to have to think about that for a later date. There's a lot of work to be done on this. This is the main operational floor. We have a hall here, and this is a backdoor entrance to the back end of the modern Cookie Monster, because there's loads of cookies jamming it up. And as you can see, there's nothing major here. I want to turn this into a showroom, really, with beds here. And I'm not sure, but pretty much you can see what's happening looking back at various bits and pieces. So I want to turn this into a furniture room and a showroom, really, for various bits and pieces in style. Here you can see a nice little hideaway room where was previously the library for enchanting. We're going to come back here in a minute, because I want to show you the mechanics. Now, I was having a real problem with this coming out with the control room design, because pretty much I was thinking about the chests and the half blocks, and what I was doing was limiting myself to the stairs, which was always a problem, and then trying to work out something based around those that kind of fashion of things was difficult. I was getting nowhere, not really being very inspirational, and net result is I was going nowhere fast, until I mentioned the problem to Brian J. And Brian J was saying that on his world, he's running one himself, and he was using black glass, black stained glass, and I thought, I can do something with that. So then I used black stained glass above some of the chests, pardon me, liked the look of it, and then went further. How about this for a pad? Yeah. Along with the black stained glass, I then decided to go for a black marble theme, or black concrete rather. That's what I ended up doing. And with, along with the black concrete, then came the black glazed terracotta. And that's how all this ended up. With a lot of the lighting being, obviously, the sea lanterns, between that and a choice of that and the glowstone. Not that much of a choice, but hey-ho, you choose what you can. I think the sea lanterns are the best ones for looking in with the black concrete, and the glowstone merges well with the terracotta. So here you have the full workings of the machine. Let's go around the other end, really. This is a light which normally stays on, and when the machine is disposing of stuff, that will flash, and as if I couldn't hear the hiss of stuff entering the lava. That is a visual warning that stuff is overflowing, so I should be concerned. I don't know whether to keep that in the final design, because some of this stuff is going to overflow quite quickly. We have a wall here of chests that are just standard chests, and I've really taken use. I think I'll avoid trapped chests in future, purely because of the way that it works. That's all I can say. Now, if I need more than these, then it's possible to extend the wall this way, you know, and have another wall of chests here, and thus turn this enchantment unit into its own little room. So that's a possibility that exists, depending on what happens and how much is needed, because I don't know. We have obviously the enchantment unit here, and a few spaces free. We've got a couple of spaces free for any future expansion, in there. Do we have two? Two? No, we have one. But I could also get rid of this column here if I needed to. I've got to see what happens. The transition outwards is not smooth, but it's pretty much the best I can get, really. We have the usual culprits to be found. And oddly enough, in this version of 1.13.2, I appear to have found a bug. In that when the background music is naturally playing, and I put a record in here, it doesn't stop the background music anymore. It used to, if you put a record on deliberately, then it used to stop the background music, so all you heard was the record. Now it doesn't, and if you get the timing wrong, you can wind up with two pieces of music playing simultaneously, and it gets all bonkers. We have a water station here for brewing up, and there's expansion for 1.14 because a number of new mechs are coming out of 1.14. Pretty much there's a few new furnaces, blast furnace, there's something else for, I think there's a loom, various other bits and pieces coming out in 1.14. So I've left myself some room for expansion there. Because it's probably going to be 1.14 before I actually manage to get around to building this damn thing. yeah. The centre of the room, as you can see, is glass, so I can see down below. And from below, if you're looking up, you can't really see too much of the terracotta because of this. Now, the way for making terracotta is clay, which is into clay blocks. Then you, I think you either colour the clay or you burn the clay into terracotta and then colour the terracotta and then burn the coloured terracotta into the glazed terracotta that you can see. Now, it's not impossible to get the amount of clay required for this kind of room. It's just going to be damned hard work. The glowstone and the rest of it is pretty standard. Now you can see a few things already coming in. You can see cooked chicken. Kelp is coming through actually quite fast, which was a bit of a concern. And that, I think, is going to trigger the overflow before anything else. Sugarcane is quite behind the kelp. Then obviously you've got coal, charcoal, and gold and iron. And feather, obviously, from the chickens, which is actually coming in at a decent rate. Yeah. You have output, input, furnace, and fuel low indicators. And this is brilliant. I saw this on Brian's server, and and a number of them are interjecting into the one stream up. So it's absolutely brilliant, and I'm just going to trigger a few things off because we're going to look at some stuff as it's happening. I'm going to set the thing running while we're talking. I'll run a number of furnacing for iron ore, and you can see it just boink, boink, boink. Yeah, it's just zooming up there. That's the fuel low indicator, which has just gone off. Now, let's have a look up. We're going to have a look at the upward mechanism first, behind the scenes. And it was a bit of a job to get all this in here. but in here it is. We have things like, this is the, there's a chest, I've blacked everything out. We have the output chest here, and a comparator, a comparator to pass through when there's something in the chest, which passes signal through here, which is then picked up, and then all that's working, which then lights the light in the corner. Here we have the main input chest, which is a simple furnace down to here, to the dispenser, and the dispenser is running the straightforward two observer, which is going to this block and then brought out by another stage 2 repeater, which is then going down and is triggering the dispenser. It's quite awkward to get it all in here and not interfering with each other. You can obviously see the same mechanism under there for the dispenser here, which is the furnace dispenser, and that's throwing up. It's got its own column here, and the lighting is upstairs. But I've used another slight version. I might change this into this sort of thing. I'm using the vertical style in order to save space on this. I'm only saving one block really, but yeah, so it's observer up there, collect the signal, and pulse down. And again, that's a one tick there, and it's going through another standard repeater there, so what the hey. So let's take a look upwards, shall we, at what's going on. We have the usual mechanic here. Everything comes up here, as you can see, and that's going in here. And we have the usual double collection for iron and gold ore, which is then fed in through these into the furnace system. The furnace input comes straight up here and straight in. Now, one of the problems I've had is this input mechanism here. You can see quite a few things coming up now. Cooked iron, some kelp, and other things. I've got to not get too close or I'll pick this stuff up. I had a problem with the timing. I mean, it's possible to use one tick on the repeater and have it going much faster. But what I found was doing that, items would collect at the top until it had all come. Like if I was firing a stack of gold up here, all the gold would collect at the top until it had finished, and then it would go off. So that was a problem. Things were not working smoothly at all, and you were running the risk if you put a lot of stuff up here of stuff actually despawning potentially. So the input triggers to these mechanisms are deliberately two ticks. They're on a two tick delay purely to get around that problem. So we have the hive off for gold, and as you can see, getting this lot to work in conjunction with each other has been a difficult process. But it does work. The coal input was interesting, and you can probably see the coal input fire. I forgot not get too close, it'll do it in a minute. But you can see the two observers which will produce the signal when it needs coal, which should happen any second, I hope, and then I'll just see the coal fire up eventually. Maybe, possibly, maybe, who knows. But yeah, okay, so maybe not. Come on. You can do it. Just for us. Anyway, while we're waiting for that. Oh, there you go. Boink, boink, boink. So you can see it's a very rapid pulse which has been caught by the repeater. So we've got the furnaces here. The first thing you'll probably notice is the uneven spread, and that is because of the timing of things. Getting things up here is too slow for a nice even spread across the hoppers before they drop down. I've tried various mechanisms in order to try and smooth out the flow, as in usually try and catch everything here for a specific time period and then release. But that hasn't worked either, because I can't get a smooth 6 out of here, or a smooth whatever. I have tried 8, I've tried 4, there's just no real way to do it that I've found yet. I'm still working on the problem, but I don't envisage an easy solution. They've all been quite complicated. I haven't even found out anything that's solved it yet. The feed requirement of we need coal comes across here and holds back a hopper here, and also gets fed down to the coal. Well, I'm out of coal light. The coal feed observers come out here and go through again, a repeat of this labeled on 2 tickers in order for the coal to go out. And yep. Relatively straightforward. By default, coal is held at a hopper under there. We then have an empty hopper here. This one, when it's got something in it, is then used to hold off. Oh, that's interesting. It's used to hold off 2 hoppers which steal coal and charcoal. What did that mean? So in other words, when that is held off and this is full, then it will not steal any coal or charcoal. But obviously there is a requirement for coal. In other words, we're using it and it's not being replenished. I'm going to have to get close to this in order to see how much is in this hopper. Okay, it's using it. Oh, I've picked up a feather. 2 feathers. So yeah, coal is being used. And if I was to feed in coal now, it would get caught and diverted. So pretty much that's what's happening. We're holding back a hopper full of coal or charcoal, which might not necessarily be full if you've got some of each. And when the system requires it, it's pulled through, fed to the necessary, to the requesting hoppers, and then fed back around into the system so that nothing really goes to waste. So that any coal doesn't back up, it comes around, and so that hopper doesn't empty unnecessarily. The coal is always available. And when the next hopper, the hopper before it, if it's got coal in it, then it will say, well, that hopper's full, so I've got some coal in here, so I don't need any more. We've already got a hopper full. Oops, pardon me. And that is what's used to hold off. And that's pretty much what's happening. There's been coal going around. So if the coal goes around, it holds off those hoppers. Because otherwise the coal comes down and charcoal comes down these 2 lanes, hits here, and would go into these chests and further on down if it wasn't for these hoppers stealing it. So if the system requires coal, these hoppers will gladly steal any coal that's or charcoal that's available and to make it available to the system. So I'm relatively consigned to there being an uneven burn on these on this coal system. If this system was actually below below and didn't actually require and could actually be fed by a gravity feed, then that would actually make the timing a lot better, and would not require the pumping up. But in order to do that, I'd have to put it below the main room. So it would be a bit of grief. Thinking about it, it would save me. The coal would still have to. No, the coal could actually be gravity fed as well. So I could make the coal gravity fed. I could actually take off the chests, but it would mean actually putting it down below. I might actually toy with that idea, and then anything which came out could then be fed straight up the straight up the one, and I could actually lose two upward feeds if I got it right, if I played my cards right. I might actually do that. This is obviously the overflow system, which comes down, and anything is pulsated out, and also the feed goes down to start flashing the light to say, hey, some stuff's being burned. It would require putting the furnace on this level, around about here, and it would require putting it in this corner and then feeding the finished items up here. That might not be a bad idea. I think I'll try that. But obviously, as you can see, we've got a lot of space here for mechanics to go in. That area, I want to make a show area. Of furniture and stuff, you know, place to put the armor stands, things like that. And you can still see that we've got an awful lot of room up here for mechanics. An awful lot of room. So, yeah. Obviously, a chunk of stuff is farming. Wheat farming, that sort of thing, pumpkins. The trick is with water, so that's why the water stuff is on the lower floor. Things like mob spawning, farming. Again, I want it to be below ground level, and tree farming. That requires a big area. It requires a very big area, and so the net result is some of the major things that are required actually wouldn't have a home here, if you know what I mean. There wouldn't be a home for them. So that's going to be interesting to find out what I do and how I get around it and what I fill this space with, which is perhaps the most interesting thing. That is the key question at the moment. What do I fill this space with? Yeah, that is interesting question number one. One of the key things is that I've just realized this is used for the coal. So if I actually brought the coal around, I could actually bring the coal feed around here, make it a shorter loop and feed it in there. So it wouldn't need, because I wouldn't need this, because it would all be at the one level. I could get rid of that, which would make things easier. And yeah, that could be very interesting. I think what I'll do is I'll just, for a start, I'll just put these back in the system. Bump, bump. Yeah. I think I'll make a copy of the mansion and attempt to rewire with everything going down. Yeah, because if I did that, I could put the furnace potentially in one of these turret areas, have it feeding off the coal and charcoal under there. Which means I could do various bits and pieces regarding the mechanisms. Yeah. It would mean I've still got the hellish areas up here to sort out, to fill with something. And I don't know what. So the problem is that the mansion actually might wind up being too big. Sorry, the chateau. Yeah. So, we've got to see what happens. I mean, I'll show you the bug right now, because we actually have music playing. If I start off, oh, there's nothing in it. Let's just get blocks on. Yeah, you can still hear the... They're both playing simultaneously. Nothing I can do about that. So yeah, I think I'll put the furnace down in that corner and see how it works out. Because it'll still need to feed in there. That's no problem, I can put another mechanism in there quite easily. In fact, that's going to be part of the plan anyway, so we might as well do it. I can just cut and paste it in. So we have that, and we have, if I put something there, to that, we will stand to one side, and copy. Then we just have to go up a floor and paste. Here, paste, and there it is, ready to go. So yes, there we go. I think I will now copy the chateau to another area and have a big think. If you've got any suggestions on what to put on these floors, I'd appreciate it, because other than this being a show floor, I've still got a heck of a lot of area to fill, which is a sizable chunk. So that's about it for this at the moment. And I shall fill you in when I know more. Will I take that? No, I don't need to. I'm going to get on with this. Where am I going to put it is the next question. Where am I going to put the copy? Yeah, I'll deal with this. So I will see you on the next installment when I've done a few more bits and pieces and had some sort of a think as to what the heck I'm going to do. Yeah. So until the next video, I shall bid you adieu and say ciao for now.